What's going on, everybody? We are back with a new episode of the Daily Grossi with the man himself, the general of the Hundred Years' War. It is Tuesday, July 16th. Tony Grossi, how are you doing?
Hey, Chops, it's great to be back. We're here for the long haul. Season starts actually this week in some NFL markets. It'll be next week for the Browns. And we're raring to go. Looking forward to a great fun time this year.
How was the sabbatical, Tony? You did about a month off. Did you get to clear your brain and, you know, get ready for a football season?
I did. A lot of mental health days on the golf courses, as you know. But by the time I'm done with my, quote, summer sabbatical, I'm looking forward to going back to the daily grind of what we do. And it's a good refresher to get us kicked off right. And we'll be heading to the Greenbrier next week and looking forward to the start of the season, really.
Yeah, Tony, you're totally right. It's here. As you mentioned, the Browns and us are going to the Greenbrier next week. As we head into training camp, Tony, what are like the big storylines that are kind of on your radar? Obviously, some of them may be pretty obvious, but like, what are you looking for as we head into camp?
Well, in general, it's the overview of the new offense, what mm-hmm. that's going to look like. We have no idea from mini camp or OTAs. Those are passing camps. It's all throwing. Once they get into regular practice routine and training camp, we'll see all the elements that Ken Dorsey is trying to bring to this offense. Of course, the continual rehab and recovery of Deshaun Watson is a story. He ended minicamp on a great note and looking to pick up at the Greenbrier where he left off. Although I think people got to understand it's a very slow ramp up to really padded practices. I think the first padded practice is until the fifth day of camp. They'll have an off day before they even have a pad day. So it's a slow ramp up, but the offense in general, Watson in specific, and also the evolution of the new running game. It's going to change. It's going to change, not only with Nick Chubb probably coming aboard later, but even once Chubb gets back on the field, how does he fit in this new run offense that Ken Dorsey is bringing? So all those storylines are offense, and other than that, the kickoff, the hybrid kickoff format, how Bubba Ventrone develops that, really, defense is almost like secondary. You figure just let Jim Schwartz develop that, and we'll see how that goes. But it's mostly the offense, I think, in the new kickoff role.
And then there's some a lot that I want to go off there, but let's start with One other thing, and that's Amari Cooper, Tony. When we last talked to you about a month ago, we were just coming off minicamp. It was a surprise absence by Amari, you know, was not excused by the team. We haven't really heard much publicly. Amari did a little, I don't know if you saw it, we posted I'm trying to get paid
for this
year.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't even that, Tony. I think he was just like, it was at a chess tournament in Dallas, actually.
Okay.
And he was just kind of talking to some guys and doing a quick interview. And he's like, I'm trying to get paid this year. Obviously, he's going to say that. You know, what are your thoughts on the Amari situation? Are we going to see him next week? Is it a hold in? What are we thinking?
Yeah, you know, first of all, the CBA terms make it very difficult for players, very expensive for players to hold out. It's a $50,000 a day mandatory fine.
Yeah.
And if you're still holding out through the games, you can miss a game check for every game you miss. And in Amari's case, that's over $1 million. So it's very expensive. I would think he's likely to hold in, which means he will report, will not be subjected to fines, but simply will not take the practice field until there's some resolution to this thing. And that's kind of a new way of protesting your contract, which I think is a better compromise than not showing up. And, you know, those fines are mandatory. It's spelled out in the CBA. So it gets pretty expensive. I think this is going to be resolved. Obviously, Amari's, I think, in a great situation because he's the number one receiver by far on this team. I don't think it's even close as we enter this season. They need him. And yet, at the age of approaching 30, he's not very marketable, I don't think, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Where is he going to go? But he deserves to be paid because he's by far one of the top five players.
And Tony, you could almost make the argument he's more valuable to the Browns than he would be to any other team, right?
Probably, unless a contender who loses a receiver, you know, he'd fit in like that. But listen, he's under contract for this year, so he's not going anywhere. Anyone who would trade for Amari Cooper would have the same contractual dilemma that the Browns have. How much do you reinvest in a 30-year-old receiver who's been great for 2 years? But, you know, I'm sure Cooper is looking at this as maybe one of his last, if not his last contract as an NFL player. And he sees the market skyrocketing. I think the model to get this thing resolved is the Michael Evans contract with Tampa Bay, who's, what, 32, has done a lot of great stuff for Tampa, and signed a three-year deal, which has pretty substantial guarantees. It pretty much means he'll be there for 3 years. I think that's what Amari's looking for, is he wants to be guaranteed to be here for more than 1 year. Yeah. And that comes down to guaranteed money.
For sure. So, yeah, so that's for sure something we're going to be watching. Tony, when will we know if he's here? Probably not until the first day at Greenbrier, right? Because they're reporting.
They are reporting in Berea first. I think the 23rd.
But we wouldn't know, would we?
We'll try to find out, but they're not yet required to report who's here and who's not. So that could be a problem. Yeah. But my understanding is the rookies are reporting, I think, the 21st.
Okay.
And then the 23rd, the entire team reports to Berea. They travel on the 24th, and 25th is the first practice at the Greenbrier. Okay. So technically, if you're supposed to report on the 23rd, he's got to be there 23rd.
So maybe obviously the Brown social media, they have the plane photos that they do. Maybe we get maybe that's how they break the news that he's there, Tony. I don't know.
You know what we used to do in the old days?
What?
We used to camp out. The Browns have held training camp, let's say, at the Lakeland Community College in Mentor.
Yeah.
And we would be in the media. We would camp out right at the dorm where they enter. They drive up and they're carrying air conditioners and stereos and all that. And that's how we would find out who's there and who's not. That, can't do that anymore because you can't get that close to the players coming in.
That reminds me, like the scene in Major League, Tony, when they're pulling up to spring training and it's, you know, they're all watching them come in.
Yeah, that's the way it was.
So Tony, you also mentioned the running game, which is going to be a big thing. Obviously, Ken Dorsey taking over. Nick Chubb has been hosting workout videos, Tony, and Gerard filled in one episode for you, and he was like, hey, that's as a former player, you're trying to send a message, maybe to even yourself, that, hey, this is what I'm doing. What do you make of those videos, and how does it impact the Browns run game now, like immediately?
Well, it's all positive that he's able to squat, 500-some pounds?
Yeah.
I know his max was over 600, I think, last year. And that's part of Chubb's routine prior to training camp is do these massive squat weight training and all that. And the good news is he's been able to do that. He's been able to get back into his off-season routine. I still think it's a long shot we see Chubb on the practice field for a while, maybe past training camp even. But all of that stuff is good news. And certainly he hasn't had a setback and he's feeling better. I mean, to put that amount of weight on that knee is, wow, what a risk. And it looked like he survived it and is on his way. But I've always speculated, if we see Chubb on the field after the bye week, that gives you pretty much 8 games of Nick Chubb at his best, and that would be a blessing, I think. And he may be back before then.
Definitely. And then looking at the rest of the running back room, Tony, is there any indication Nyheim Hines sat out the offseason program, at least, you know, from practice and everything?
Yeah.
Do we think he's going to be back for camp, or
Well, he said that's why he was holding back, so that he would be ready for the start of camp. So, okay. So we'll see. You know, his was a more common ACL injury, non-playing, you know, sitting on a Ski-Doo or
jet ski. Yeah.
Jet ski. I think it was the other brand, though, Ski-Doo. And someone collided with him. That's how he hurt his knee, missed all of last year. But from all the interviews he's given, Hines sounds like he has always earmarked the start of camp to be ready. So that's what I would expect.
So then when you, Tony, I know this is concerning to you, the running game and how it's shifting to Dorsey's offense. Is there anything in camp or preseason that would alleviate your concerns, or like anything that you could see, or do we have to see it in a game?
No, the preseason games for sure. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's anything in practice we're going to see that's going to make me comfortable.
Yeah,
with the changes. Listen, all we have to go on is Buffalo's running game under Dorsey. You know, as the coordinator, that's the only team he was a coordinator for. You know, he did great work with Cam Newton as a quarterback's coach. Then he started in Buffalo as quarterback coach, and then as coordinator, their running game was not acceptable. So maybe he's learned from that, and we'll see how it evolves. But I don't think we'll be able to note much. Until the games themselves, because in the minicamp and OTAs, all I saw were shotgun snaps, but that's understandable because it was pretty much it was all passing. Yeah. So I won't be relieved until I see Jerome Ford break out a few long runs in the preseason games.
There we go. Tony, a few weeks ago, I was kind of looking at the Browns roster. This is a very deep roster. Have you tried to do like a 53 man? Like, have you looked at it? Are we going to have any training camp battles? Like, do you anticipate anything like that? You know, in years past, we've seen that. Do you anticipate anything like that with this roster?
Yeah. Well, from now until we depart for Greenbrier, I'm going to have daily stuff. So I'll get into that, you know, each day, but there aren't many battles, you know. Even at cornerback, you know, last year I thought the number two cornerback position was a legit battle, but the same threesome is there, and the roles are pretty defined. You know, Newsom's the slot corner, and MJ Emerson's the outside corner, and when they go to two corners, we could see either one of them being that second corner. You know, Quentin Jefferson's a new piece to the puzzle up front. Defensive tackle. I think he's got to earn a starting spot, but I expect him to be the starter on first downs next to Dalvin Tomlinson. You know, return specialists, you know, if Hines is, we're going to have two returners on this new kickoff format. Will it be Hines and James Prochet? Will it be Pierre Strong? Will it be the rookie who they're trying to get, Jamari Thrash, who's got to do something besides just play receiver? And even though he was in a returner at Louisville, they're training him there. So that whole kickoff thing is going to be interesting as a position battle, I think. I'll tell you what, I'd like to see Bubba Ventrone train somebody else to be the kickoff specialist. I really think that Andy Reid's got the right idea. They're going to try Justin Reed, a safety. I think
Tony, if you could pick one, who would it be?
Well, DeAnthony Bell, you know, did kickoffs in high school or something. That's why he was the emergency guy in that game against Houston.
Just let him do Christmas it. Eve.
Well, I mean, he did it without any training. That's the thing. You have to decide. It's going to be one of my first questions to Bubba. Ventrone is, have you revisited? Because I asked him in minicamp, do you see possibly training someone to be a kickoff specialist? And he was against the idea. He thinks the kickoff is an art and is not the easiest thing to do. But I wonder if he's revisited that. It would definitely be a defensive player, because that guy's a potential tackler more so than the old kickoff format.
What are the odds if the guy behind you in that photo, you know, he's been petitioning to be on, not kicking off, but on kickoff. What are the odds if that happens?
Well, I don't think I would risk a Myles Garrett on the kickoff turn.
No.
I mean, he would be definitely a terror to the return teams, you know, but the risk is too much. I'm talking about a backup safety,
yeah,
or third safety, or even a linebacker. Train this new rookie linebacker, Watson, Nathaniel Watson, who's going to be instrumental on kickoff teams. Train somebody like that. I'd like to see it.
For sure. As we wrap up here, Tony, there's another position I want to talk about. I think it was over the 4th of July, but Jack Conklin on Instagram had a kind of a heartfelt post like, hey, rehab's tough, all this. And then at the end of it, he's like, I'm back.
Good.
We don't know what that means specifically, but Tony, apples to apples, who is your starting right tackle right now as we head into camp?
Well, there's no doubt. If he's healthy, it's Conklin in my mind.
Okay.
Definitely. The question is, how long can he stay there without suffering something again? You know, there's been just so many of those. But he's put in so much time to come back. I think he earned it if he's healthy.
Okay.
His contract is such that you got to play him if he's healthy.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he's a better player right now than DeJuan Jones. DeJuan Jones' ceiling is off the charts, but right now he is. So I think that's the best possible situation would be Conklin being healthy and DeJuan Jones being there if needed.
So would that in your mind make DeJuan Jones a swing tackle? Because technically your swing tackle should be able to play on both sides.
Yeah.
Or is it he's just kind of that right tackle waiting?
Yeah, we'll see in camp if he lines up at left tackle. He did not at minicamp.
Yeah.
That's not something you just say, okay, go play left tackle. I mean, you gotta train it. You gotta start from day one training him at left tackle. And so far, I don't think there's any sign of that. And don't forget, they added a couple veteran tackles this year to be kind of like the left tackle backup. And you also have James Hudson still on the list, on the roster. So I don't see them converting him to left tackle swing this year.
So do you think that's good for DeJuan Jones if he's kind of the backup to Conklin starting, you know?
His time will come. I mean, it came in week three, week two last year.
It came very quick.
Yeah. I don't think there's any rush that we got to get this guy in the field.
Yeah. And
that would be the case if you didn't have a healthy Conklin. But if you have a healthy Jack Conklin, I think he goes back to right tackle.
Definitely. Well, Tony, it's great to have you back because that means the football's close, and that's a great sign for everybody. Can't wait to talk to you more. Can't wait to see what you put out this week. And then we head to West Virginia next week.
It's a fun time. And you know what? The training camp to me is the most boring. For an analyst / beat writer, anyone who covers this team day to day, training camp to me is the worst, especially the period of time before the first preseason game where you have now this slow ramp up. So I am so in favor of breaking up the monotony of that and going to the Greenbrier. I thought it was fine last year. I think it's going to be fine this year. And unfortunately, there's only 6 open practices in Berea. There's a lot of construction going on at that complex. Yeah.
Did you see that house, Tony? The last house standing is gone. That happened while you were...
Yeah. Yeah, so we're going to see construction cranes building this development stuff. But for people who enjoy training camp, I commiserate with you. You only have 6 open practices. But I think after this year is completed and they do that development outside the facility, I think then the next point of business is to make training camp more fan-friendly in the future starting next year.
Definitely.
So just be patient.
What training camp is this for you, Tony?
I think it's going to be my 40th -3. Okay, so the 3 years the Browns didn't participate.
Yeah.
I covered the league, but I didn't cover a training camp, although I went to a couple training camps for visits. So Browns camp, I think this is my 37th. I think it'll be my 37th. That's a lot of time. Hey, that's a lot of time watching grass grow. Believe me, it is the most boring time of the year for me.
What's the one thing, because Riz always talks about this, what's the one thing that's so different between old school training camp and today?
Oh, accessibility.
Okay.
Accessibility. I mean, you've been out of training camp. You can't step on the grass. You got to be behind the line. Man, when I started covering the Browns, between periods, we would joke with players and talk with players on their water breaks. And it was,
imagine that.
Yeah. I mean, we'd hear them talking. We were that close to, about what just happened on the field. Accessibility has been, we've been pushed back.
For sure. For sure. Also, just talking with old times, want to send thoughts, wishes, Bernie Kosar, Tony, you know, he did make the announcement about his health. You know, always thinking about Bernie, great guy, obviously, yeah. Browns legend.
Keep him in your prayers. He needs a lot of prayers, battling a lot of things, but he is a battler. There's no question about that. So our thoughts are always with him.
Definitely. Thank you, Tony. We'll talk to you tomorrow. And then we're here. It's football.
That's right. Let's go.
Do it.